see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Welcome back to the It's in Queens podcast. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons, and this is the only podcast that focuses on Queens, the borough with something for everyone. This podcast is brought to you each week by the Queens Tourism Council and the Queens Economic Development Corporation, and it has been my pleasure to support them over this past year and to engage in conversations with the people who make this borough a fantastic place in which to live, work, or visit. I love exploring the borough, and sometimes that means just taking a new route to get to my destination, like I did when I took mostly side streets to get to Aqueduct to get vaccinated earlier this year. Now, true, it did take me considerably longer to get there, but when I take these more leisurely drives, I'm also looking out for new parks or businesses or cultural amenities that I'd never seen before. I also pay attention to street names, and always wonder where they came from, if I don't recognize the name, of course. Recently, I attended a street renaming ceremony at 43rd Avenue and Judge Street for a woman who lived in the area after being exiled from Poland for fighting the oppressive regimes of 1940s Europe. That same day, a few neighborhoods over, a street was being renamed for Hall of Fame Yankee pitcher Whitey Ford. And so, this past weekend, I dove into a book called Names of New York by Joshua Jelly Shapiro that offered a wonderful look at the history of many of the names around our city, and of course, that had to include Queens. One thing I learned, there are no fewer than 10 streets in our borough that have the name Frank in them. Can someone name them all for me? Of course, in my neighborhood in Jackson Heights, there's also a corner sign on 35th Avenue near the Community Methodist Church where the world's most popular board game, Scrabble, was created. Now, I could go on. This book was chock full of revelations, but suffice it to say, if you're curious about your neighborhood, how it got its name, like Astoria, and I will not give that away, or a bridge, or a borough park, it's worth picking up this book. And I'll be interviewing the author on Sunday, October 10th on WBAI 99.5 FM at 10 in the morning if you want more insight into this. When I read, I enjoy putting on some music. It has to be classical or chilled cow or even opera. All of them set a nice, comfortable tone, a nice calming atmosphere, and it helps me to tune out one of my neighbors who decides to always make loud phone calls right at his window right across the courtyard. I've been to the opera only a handful of times in my life, but one occasion stands out more than the rest. Flushing Town Hall debuted Queens Opera Theater a few years ago, and it drew a full house. This is Queens' only professional opera theater, and it makes opera accessible to all ages of music lovers. So this week, I talk with Executive Director Brian Gill, who founded Queens Opera Theater 5 years ago. Brian Gill, welcome to the It's in Queens podcast.
It's very nice to be here. Thanks so much for the invitation.
So I know that you last joined Rob McKay and Chris Donovan, the previous hosts of this podcast, before the pandemic. So as much as you've introduced Queens Opera Theater before, for those who are new to the podcast, I'd love for them to know more about you and about Queens Opera Theater.
Sure, absolutely. So I'll give my quick sort of elevator speech and to let everyone know on the listening to the podcast, I was born and raised in San Antonio, Texas, and I was first introduced to opera and firstly operetta by my grandfather, who you know, very quickly discovered an interest and passed on his record collection to me. And you know, I like to think back in retrospect that, you know, he was really planting a seed, but he didn't push me, you know, into it. He just said, here, I think you might enjoy this. So one of my first operettas I remember listening to and enjoying was HMS Pinafore, Gilbert and Sullivan. And then later on, I listened to some a recording of La Boheme. I think that was his, and then he gave to my mother. And so I followed that career or sort of that path into public school music. I was very fortunate to have two great music directors and sort of led me down that path. And then went on to university and eventually grad school in Michigan, and then came to New York about 10 years ago or a little more, and worked in the administrations at Carnegie Hall and as well as St. Thomas Church on Fifth Avenue. And I think that's really where I forged or sort of elevated my interest in classical vocal music and therefore opera. I was also doing some side work ushering at the Metropolitan Opera. So great way to, you know, take a deep dive into the platform.
And what brought you to Queens? Why move to Queens?
Okay, great question. So my wife and I first moved to the Upper West Side naturally made the inclination and the transition, if I was going to truly build Queens Opera Theater, that it was absolutely essential for us to be fully ensconced in the borough of Queens. So started looking, and in April of 2019, we moved to a rental right in Forest Hills in the gardens, which we very much enjoyed. And actually, just as a quick aside, we are in the process of hoping to close soon on a co-op. So you know, I've always loved the borough of Queens. Before my wife and I met, my first apartment was right on Ditmars Boulevard in Astoria. So I've had a long developed affinity. So happy to be here.
So I want to go back to something you said. You mentioned HMS Pinafore. What was it about that, or what was it just about opera that made you fall in love?
I believe the marrying of all three forms. You know, you have vocal, you have music, you have costumes. In the case of Pinafore, you know, it's a lighthearted comedy and sung in English. Sometimes that can be a barrier, if you don't speak Italian, for example, or French, although they do offer librettos and, ways of becoming more comfortable with those types of productions. But I love the connection. I love the method of storytelling, I guess that's really I can't really say too much more about that.
So many of us, you know, we enjoy something, we love it. I'll use opera as an example. So we listen to opera, we love it, but you took that extra step. You said, let us found the Queens Opera Theater. Why make that jump?
I quickly discovered in looking at the borough of Queens that there was, at the time of our sort of generating the idea and planting the seed back as early as 2016 or 15, at that time, there was not to my knowledge, there was not a professional opera company in the entire borough of Queens. You know, everyone is fully aware that just across the river, the Metropolitan Opera, fully well established with a wonderful reputation in Manhattan. And we really saw that there was a need and an interest and plenty of audience members who really enjoyed the performance meeting, but for assorted reasons were not able to make the leap and attend a performance at the Metropolitan Opera. And that point was really proven in our opening season preview concert at Flushing Town Hall in 2017, which we presented free to the community. And we actually had to, unfortunately, we were full up, and were any more, if we had allowed any more people, and we were very close to being shut down by the fire department, you know, because of the fire code, which is a happy problem.
I was going to say, it's a good problem to have.
It's a great problem to have. Yeah. Yeah.
Although I know Ellen Kodadek will be very strict and want her to listen to this. She'll be very strict. You can't, you know, violate the fire code.
Yes, absolutely. And we fully honored that. And, you know, it just really proved the point that we're in the right place and right time for bringing opera to the world's most diverse borough.
And so what makes Queen's Opera Theater so distinctive, and who are your members? Who are, you know, who are the people that have become part of your community?
Sure. Well, I will say that what makes us distinctive as a company is that we offer to the community affordable and accessible productions to all. And also we educate our audiences about not only opera heritage, but also the natural connection to operetta and musical theater, marrying all three of those platforms into Queen's Opera Theater. I say that just to clarify is that, you know, our performance space, primary performance space, is indeed Flushing Town Hall. So I don't want to mislead anyone on the listening to the podcast. Our name is purely that, Queen's Opera Theater. We have partnerships with Flushing Town Hall where we present our performances.
So what was the last year, the last 17 months like for you and Queen's Opera Theater? Everyone has gone through so much in this period.
Yeah, absolutely. I used the last 17 months really to recharge, refresh, and reevaluate where we have been and where we are going in the next 5 to 10 years. I used the period to forge contacts, all via Zoom, virtually, and form partnerships with the Astoria Performing Arts Center, as well as the administration at Forest Park, which I'll get to in a moment when we talk about our season. And so I used that as a period of renewal. And we did not present. I know many other companies did a lot of things virtually. I took full advantage of those, and as well as, you know, online discussions with opera presentations by Opera America and other and the Association of Performing Arts Presenters, and, you know, discussions on how we were all dealing with the pandemic and how we were going to come out of it. And so used it to really expand my web.
And in talking about where you're going, let's go there now. So what is on the horizon? I mean, I feel like from what I've seen online, you're going to have a busier season coming up.
Yes. So we are delighted to be partnering with the Astoria Performing Arts Center right there at Kaufman Astoria Studios to do a holiday production. The first two weekends, Friday night and Saturday performances, the 4th and 5th, and then the 10th and 11th of December, of Peter Ekstrom's wonderful holiday holiday production of The Gift of the Magi. And incidentally, that was our first production in 2000, full production we have done at Flushing Town Hall. So I'm using this season as a rebirth or a renaissance. And so we're delighted to be partnering and presenting that at Flushing Town Hall. I'm sorry, at the Astoria Performing Arts Center.
I was just going to say, wait. But I do remember the Flushing Town Hall performance.
Yes. So it will be a similar format. We will present it in the small 1,200 square foot black box space. I think we'll be very you know, it's a small, intimate show, as you may remember from seeing it at Flushing Town Hall. And we'll do it semi-staged. We're hoping to, again, partner with costumes from the TDF costume collection, which also conveniently is housed right there across the street from the studios in Astoria. And we'll present it again with piano accompaniment. I have been in touch with the composer again, Peter Ekstrom, who is still very hesitant to travel, but has been very supportive and is delighted, you know, that we're going to be presenting Gift of the Magi again.
And by the way, sound effects on this podcast are natural. So hearing dogs, this happens with me too.
Okay. Yes. Thank you. So then moving on, we will present a holiday cabaret on the 16th and 17th of December at Church in the Gardens in Forest Hills. And we'll be presenting that also in another partnership with Musica Regine Productions. And that will feature soprano Christina Pecci with her accompanist Matthew Stevens. And Christina and I know each other through a family connection. And she is based in Chicago, has had a distinguished career in opera, but has more recently transitioned into more of a cabaret. And she has a whole holiday themed program around sort of the witches and divas that appear in not only in opera, but in musical theater. And we'll present that, as I said, over the two evenings at Church in the Gardens. And what I'm, I wouldn't say, well, I'm proud of all of the productions, but hoping and that we will be able to present some to a date to be determined still in spring 22 or maybe even fall 22 at the Bandshell at Forest Park, a fully socially distanced Queen's premiere of a one act opera entitled Lady Bird, First Lady of the Land. It was world premiered at Texas State University in South Texas. And I've been in touch with the composer, Henry Mullicone on the West Coast, and his librettist, who is a very spry, I believe 97 or 98 year old Sheldon Harnick, who many of our listeners may be familiar with as writing a little show that I think is going to be a great hit called Fiddler on the Roof.
Know it very well, including in Yiddish.
Yeah, yes, indeed. And so we're hoping to present that. And I've also been in touch and with getting the original director of that production aligned with us, as well as the original stage director, who is currently on the faculty at Johns Hopkins, or Peabody Conservatory at Johns Hopkins.
So now I'm going to put you on the spot. Now I'm going to get to your favorite picks. This is where you have to choose.
Okay.
Let our listeners know of a restaurant you recommend in Queens. What is one of your favorite places to go to?
That's a very, very easy answer for me. Right on Metropolitan Avenue, wonderful Italian gym, Il Poeta, is one of our favorite spots.
What do you like about it?
Yeah, well, obviously the service is top notch, and the chef Mario is he's always out, you know, looking after the customers, when making sure everything is okay. And it's small, intimate. There are about 10 tables or so. And I also applaud the fact that he was able to adapt, as many restaurants were during the pandemic, and able to survive. I mean, we all they all had their issues, but you know, we wanted to continue to support our local businesses and local community members.
And the other question I've started, or I've now remembered to ask each person, each guest, is a destination. I'm curious if there's a place in Queens, something that maybe people might not think of right away, but a place that you would recommend they visit.
Sure. I enjoy just taking a walk, a different route each day within the neighborhood, Forest Hills. And, you know, one of those destinations that I discovered was Forest Park. And just both during the pandemic and prior to the pandemic, I just enjoyed going out on a, you know, on a Saturday morning, crossing over and sort of leaving behind the traffic noise, you know, on Metropolitan and also the Parkway. You know, you can really just go and forget you're in this very busy metropolitan area. Very similar experience that you would one would have in Central Park, but far more accessible to the residents of Queens.
So we've got just about a minute or so left, and we've talked about some of the songs that you that inspired you to pursue this. You know, for anyone who's not familiar with opera, what's a good way for a newcomer to start to experience it?
I would say I suggest people look online at a very famous Bugs Bunny cartoon called What's Opera, Doc? And sort of an iconic cartoon. And that's really sort of gives a good intro to opera, and it presents it in a more utilitarian fashion. And I also would recommend, there's a wonderful book called The Victor Book of the Opera, Victor as in RCA Victor. And if you can't find it in the bookstore, I'm sure the Queens Library can track it down for those who are interested. And that really, that actually, that was published about 1925. So it was sort of every opera that was composed and popular up until that point. But it really gives a good primer to first-time listeners and fans.
And briefly, you did mention about how you've spent the last 17 or so months. You've thought about where you've been and where you're going. Where do you see Queens Opera Theater going in the next 5 to 10 years?
Well, I'm hopeful to expand our collaborations with other Queens-based artistic organizations. For example, looking to still to be determined, but have had initial contacts with Carisha Batan with the Queensboro Dance Festival about thinking about some how we could collaborate and work together. And even more imminently, I am hopeful to forge a partnership with the Queensboro Football Club to where we would showcase opera singers to sing the national anthems of the visiting football teams. And I will add that they'll give a little plug for Queensboro Football Club. They are due to have their first match in the spring of 2022 on the campus of York College.
And in fact, they will be a guest here on the It's in Queens podcast coming up. We've already booked them.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
So Brian, if our listeners want to learn more about Queens Opera Theater and also find out more about the Gift of the Magi or the Holiday Cabaret, where should they go?
They should feel free to visit our website, Queens Opera Theater. And I will say that we employ the continental spelling of theater. So that's Queens Opera, theatre.org. We also are present on Facebook and Instagram and even TikTok. Although still sort of getting used to the TikTok motivation platform, but those would be the key spots to visit. And I will just, if I may add just a quick plug, our website was recently rebranded, and we're very grateful to the services of Amelia Schussler creative out of Sarasota, Florida.
Brian Gill, thank you so much for appearing here today on the It's in Queens podcast.
Thank you so much for the opportunity.
And that was my conversation with Brian Gill, founder of Queens Opera Theater. Once again, the website address is Queens Opera Theater, and that's R-E, queensoperatheater.org. And what's not to love? Opera has something for everyone, like Queens does. It's got drama, visual arts, dance, and a combination of vocal and orchestral music. So mark your calendars for December for the Gift of the Magi and a holiday cabaret and step into the world of Queens Opera Theater. Now, that is months away. Between now and then, there are ample opportunities to have fun or discover a new place in Queens. I cannot keep track of them all. But you know who does? Rob McKay. Rob is with the Queens Tourism Council and Queens Economic Development Corporation, and each week, he shines a light on a few of the more exciting events on the horizon. Here's this week's report.
Jeff, it's always a pleasure to be on your podcast. Listen, I got to do something selfish, which is promote Queens Comes Back, which is this Saturday, October 9th from noon to 4. We're organizing it. The agency I work for, the Queens Economic Development Corporation. But right now, I can give you all the inside details. We have 41 vendors. That's 41. They're going to be selling everything from food to beverages to jewelry to T-shirts, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Some of them are completely new food people, so I'm excited to try them. And beyond that, the event, which we're calling Queens Comes Back because it's kind of like our celebration of the fact that the borough has survived COVID. It's going on at the Kaufman Astoria Studios backlot, which is right there on 36th Avenue and 34th Street. It's probably the most famous backlot that you didn't know you've seen, because it's where many of the major Hollywood movie studios film their stunts. So it's this really cool, iconic Queens area. It's sort of an indoor, enclosed New York City block owned by Kaufman Astoria Studios. So we're gonna have all of these vendors in this really cool place. And then on top of that, Queensborough Dance Festival, which a woman named Carissa Baton does, who's been on this podcast. She organizes dance performances around the city, around Queens during the summer. She's chosen four troupes to perform. So it'll be interesting to see what they do at this spot, what they choose to, the choreography that they choose. So we're talking great food, great beverages, great items and to buy, great art and great spot. And let's say a quick prayer for great weather as well. That's October 9th, noon to 4. And like I said, it's at the Astoria, the Kaufman Arts Astoria. Kaufman Astoria Studios backlot is what it's called. It's located in the Kaufman Arts District, so it gets a little bit confusing. But beyond that, the other thing I wanted to, there were kind of two other things I wanted to promote quickly. The Greater New York Show, which is an annual exhibit at MoMA PS1. It opens October 7th and runs to April 18th. I was just there this morning taking photos. It's absolutely fantastic. There's work by 47 different artists and or collaborations. Everything you can imagine, from paintings to photography to large scale installations. Is fantastic. And MoMA PS1 is just a great place to hang out, all the nooks and crannies and everything that they have at that place. So again, the show is called Greater New York. It's October 7th to October 18th at MoMA PS1. And then one other thing for my homeboys in Astoria, the New York Greek Film Expo is going on. It's going on all around the city, but of course, Museum of the Moving Image, which is in Astoria, or again, Astoria's Kaufman Arts District, they're going to be showing some brand new Greek movies from October 8th to October 10th. So there's nothing like a big fat Greek movie. So you can check them out October 8th to October 10th at the Museum of the Moving Image. Back to you, Jeff. Thanks.
That was Rob McKay of the Queens Tourism Council and Queens Economic Development Corporation. I ventured outside today just before sitting down to prepare this week's podcast, and the new fall season is full steam ahead. I really had to resist buying quite a few pumpkins at the farmer's market. I'm already dreaming of what dishes I can make with pumpkin this season. My husband's going to go crazy with all the cooking I'm going to do that all has pumpkin as a base. Now, you don't have to leave the borough to go to a pumpkin patch. There are plenty of places here that you'll find them, such as the Queens County Farm Museum in Glen Oaks. They host a pumpkin patch until the end of the month. You want more details on that and more? Here's where you can get them. Head to the It's in Queens website. The web address is It's in Queens. You can't forget that. It'sinqueens.com. Bookmark it on your desktop. That way, it'll be very easy to plan ahead, or you could make it even easier. You can get notified right in your inbox. The way to do that is to sign up for the Queens Economic Development Corporation's newsletter at queensny.org. And remember, not just during the fall season, but around the year, no matter where you are in Queens, tag us on Twitter. Use the hashtag #ItsInQueens. Or just follow us at It's in Queens. I'm your host, Jeff Simmons, and that's it for this week's It's in Queens podcast. Have a great fall.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them bloom for me and you. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. I see skies of blue and clouds of white, the bright blessed day, the dark sacred night, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the sky, are also on the faces.